So how many said I have $20? Show of hands. How many says I have minus 20? Some other number that you can name that everybody here knows or should know? Or need more information? All right, maybe you're just going with the crowd here. How do you know they're right? They know that you know they're right because obviously none of you have much of an idea how much money I actually have, and that's, you know, irrelevant. The interaction is what we know about. We know about how things changed. I transfer one joule of energy to this thing. What's the energy of this thing? Who knows? You have to add up all the energies and try to figure it out. Really hard problem. The way to really figure it out probably is to put this in an isolated container and keep adding energy and adding energy and adding energy until you've blasted it all into a million protons, not a million, 10 to the 26th protons and electrons and neutrons, and they're all completely separate from each other, and however much energy you needed to do that, that's how much energy was negative, was in there in some sense. It's hard to, in fact, I feel like saying, and I'll say it right at the beginning, that the absolute amount of energy is ill-defined. We will give you a specific way of standardly defining absolute amounts of energy, but chemical bond energies are a little bit ill-defined. If you look up chemical bond energies of any kind, what you find is changes in energy. You look up the chemical bond energy you look up the binding energy of an O2 molecule. That tells you how much energy it took to break the O2 molecule. It doesn't tell you how much it had at the end. It doesn't tell you how much it has at the end or at the beginning. It tells you how much you had to add to break it apart. It tells you about energy changes. Almost every energy you look up will tell you that. Yeah?
But that's assuming I don't know my initial amount that I have, right? Because, I mean, the way I read it, it's like, personally to me, if I know the amount of cash I have in my pocket right now and you give me $20, then the answer would be C. It's a specific amount that I know. But the question was, if someone gives another person... $20,
the question was about me. Yeah.
So that's from my perspective, right? And therefore, that's why it's a D. Because the way I read it, it's about me. And from my perspective, I know how much money I have. So it would be C.
Okay, so if that comes up again, if that comes up again, if I write me, I wrote the question, I'm talking about me. If I write you, I either mean you personally or I mean you as a kind of a general group. So I'm as person-centered as anyone, probably. If I say me, I'm only talking about one person. There is an interpretation issue. On the other hand, I suspect that because of the way money is, or things are valued, that even though you might know how much cash you have in your pocket, you probably don't know how much liquid assets you have exactly. Almost none of you probably know that. And you certainly don't know your net worth. I mean, nobody really, those things are numbers that can change around a little bit. And so you can't know those things very well. Just like the energy of the bowling ball, it interacts with the room. So energy is constantly being exchanged back and forth all the time. The average exchange is zero, but the bowling ball's energy is going up and down a little bit all the time. And economics is a little bit the same way. It's changes during one interaction that are important. Most important. Any other questions on that? I mean, you're right, and I do want you to think carefully about things. So I want these kinds of, you know, you might call them picky. Okay, I don't want them if they are picky. But I do want them if there's an issue that we should think about. So I've already told you about energy. This is how we think about one of the ways we think about interactions in the world. is exchanges of energy. If there are interactions, energy may be exchanged. It may not, but it might be. Here's the situation where it's not exchanged. The earth pulls down on this. The wire pulls up. The wire is pulling up just as hard as the earth is pulling down. No energy is exchanged in those two interactions. Neither of them is exchanging energy, so the energy of the ball doesn't change because of those two. It might change because of other interactions, but those two end up not transferring energy. So it doesn't have to be that energy is transferred in an interaction, but it often is. So I just put this up here because I wanted to say, number one, that the SI unit of energy is joules. You probably already know that. That there are a set of energies that we will use early in the quarter. In the first couple of weeks, the main energies we'll use are thermal energy and bond energy. Thermal energy and bond energy. Which do you suppose changed if I put my hands on this bowling ball? Which of the energies of the bowling ball changes? If we're only talking about thermal and bond, which is the one that's going up? Thermal energy is going up. This bowling ball gets hotter. Thermal energy is going to be our name for energies associated with changes in the temperature. The indicator is over here on the right. The energy is over on the left. What indicates whether thermal energy has changed? Did the temperature change of that physical system? What about bond energy? How would I change the bond energy of this? How would I add energy to that bowling ball and change its bond energy? Can you think of one way?
Melt it.
That breaks a bunch of bonds. Enough of them that it now spills out onto the floor. It still holds together. The bowling ball would still be a liquid that held together. I could break a lot more bonds through another process after I add heat. What would happen to the bowling ball if I kept adding heat to it, to this liquid? Eventually I'd vaporize it. Eventually I'd turn it into a gas. I'd break a bunch more bonds. Less maybe sophisticated ways of breaking bonds that we won't talk about that much is that I could take an axe and cut the thing into two pieces. All right, I really can't do it. I could take a saw and cut that into two pieces. And that would break a bunch of bonds, including all the pieces that are lying around, the sawdust that's lying around at the end. Lots of bonds broken. You have to add energy to break bonds. If I want to break this thing apart, I have to do something to it, add energy to it, and break it into two pieces. Otherwise, it stays stuck together. The indicator for, we'll talk about these others later. You might have heard of energy of motion, kinetic energy. That's when things speed up and slow down. Or potential energy. We'll talk about those in a week or so. Bond energy changes, phase changes, was exactly what you mentioned, melting. What about photosynthesis? Think about photosynthesis for a second. You got a molecule. Sunlight comes in. It's in mixed with other stuff. Sunlight comes in. All of the stuff that gets mixed together and changes around and becomes a sugar. Did the bond energy go up or down? How do you know it went up? Because the end result has more energy. How do you know that? Just from what I said, what I told you about the process. Yeah. Yeah, energy came in. It's like I added $20 to the system, only I added a little bit of energy to the system. So some energy had to go up. When you walk out in the sun, You don't end up with higher bond energy and a lot of sugar. You have a different energy that goes up, if anything. Thermal energy. You get hotter. That's what the sun does for you. It can do that for plants too, of course, but plants sitting out there in the sun don't change their temperature because the sun is hitting it. They have a constant inflow of energy from the sun and outflow of, for some other reason, they stay at the same temperature, but photosynthesis can happen, so some of the sun's energy goes into bond energy, and you end up with sugar with higher bond energies.